Welcome to Answers from the Universe and the Andronicus Transmissions on Wolf Spirit Radio, Ever Beyond Radio, and Studio 9 Jam on YouTube. With your host, Jessica Ariel Morocco, featuring JP as the voice of Andronicus. Please visit www.readingsbyrael.com, that's A-R-A-E-L.
We came from the future, by way of past. I bought my ticket for the 15th century. We started moving through a hole in history.
You're listening to Wolf Spirit Radio.
Good day, everyone, and thank you for joining us here at Answers from the Universe and the Andronicus Transmissions. I'm here with JP, and we're also going to have two guests today. We have the wonderful honor of having Petra come through, and Petra, of course, chooses Amy Delgado to be her voice. And Petra has a message for us today. And, you know, Amy, when she was telling me she was visiting Greece, and she kept on saying, well, maybe Petra will come through and have a message. And last week she asked me, and I said, no, I didn't hear anything. And then today she said something, and I was like, no, I don't hear anything again. And then later on today, I got the message, and she's like, oh, I have to run up all the stairs to the villa now. I was like, and so we have Amy here, and I'm so grateful that she came on. And before I bring her in, I also want to mention that we have Larry Buell from Earthlands in Petersham, Massachusetts, who I had a wonderful time, honored to meet with. He's doing an amazing project, and I went there with a friend, and met many new friends as well there, and they're doing some amazing work. And it's very much in the energy and the essence of Findhorn. So,
Hello, I've cut off Jessica. I'm sorry. I'll have to bring you into the call. Oh. What the hell's that? Sorry about this, everybody.
Resume call. To hear that, that would have to be, we ended up putting that on the second show, which was the intergalactic roundtable and with Viking. So I'm trying to remember what that date was, JP. Do you recall that date?
Sorry, your guest called in and cut off this connection for some reason. And so I didn't actually hear what you just said. So could just like for the last minute of what you were saying, because the call came in. So I lost,
oh, okay.
I lost what you were saying.
Was my guest Larry or?
Yeah, it was your guest Larry. But he, okay, for some reason, called in and Skype wasn't handling it properly. Everything's going bizarre again. We're having one of those days, right?
So was everyone not hearing, or is just you didn't hear that part?
Me and everybody, yeah.
Oh, okay.
So
All right. Just
the last minute or so. So you were talking about getting your friend Larry on the show, and then he called in, and then it went quiet. So if you want to sort of start from where you getting your friend Larry on.
Yeah, so Larry, like I said, is coming from Earthlands, and he will be here with us at the end of the show, the last half hour or so, or when we finish the transmissions, because, of course, my commitment is to provide the transmissions for everyone and what is going on and keep everyone up to date. And in the end, if we have time for discussion or for a guest, that's what I do is I bring someone in. But, yeah, I'm sure Larry's very enthusiastic and excited to come on and share what he's doing. And like I said, he's doing some very similar work, or has a similar dream as Findhorn, as well as many other projects. But so we'll proceed. And then what I also went on to say is that those who were looking to hear the Bigfoot voice that was on Max Steele's, he had a phone call or a message, and I felt that a Bigfoot somehow got into his phone system and left a message. And he was able to assist in the Bigfoot. He does communicate with the Bigfoot, and we had a discussion about it. And so this whole thing has been going on. But I did tell everyone last week that if you wanted to hear it, stay tuned, but it never happened on my show. It happened the following show on the Intergalactic Council, which was last Thursday, and I'm trying to remember the date, so today's the 4th, August 4th. So it would be in the archives of Viking's show, the Intergalactic Roundtable.
It's the 28th, so it'll be 2016-07-28. And okay. It'll be, I think it's IRT, Intergalactic, Interstellar Roundtable or something. We've got all these intras and ultras and all this stuff, and it's getting confusing.
Yeah. So. I know, I'm just like, too much information, but we want to make sure that, you know, I apologize. I meant to have him on the show. Things ran over. But he did an amazing job. And also, what you will hear on that show is Max Steele's description of his interaction with the Bigfoot. And I find it quite detailed and highly interesting. And, of course, Max is a very interesting person anyhow, having that connection with the many visitors here on the planet and off planet. So he, like myself, we have that kind of connection. So it's important that we provide that to the public. I'd like to say on a lighter note, but I think it's another slightly serious show. We have some more information that came through that I wasn't expecting, but I believe that they're working through this stuff. And I just want to bring in Amy so she can say hello from Greece and tell us what's going on there.
Yes, us. Y calispera. Hello, Jess, and hello, JP.
Hello.
Can you hear me okay?
Yes.
Perfectly.
Great. Well, it's evening here, and the sun is going down. It's very lovely, and my dear husband organized a whole lovely wedding for me because 20 years ago, our parents weren't in agreement that we should get married. And so he felt like he never gave me an opportunity to have a lovely wedding, a lovely dress. And so he organized this beautiful event with our families, my German-American family and his Spanish family. And everybody accepted our very beautiful hand-fasting vows that we exchanged yesterday. And it was very peaceful and loving. All the family was very accepting after 20 years.
Wow. Yeah, that you hung in there. And, you know, sometimes love is more powerful than anything else, isn't it?
It really is, yeah.
That's beautiful.
Thank you. So I'm very happy.
Yeah, congratulations. And thank you also. Meanwhile, you're you know, redoing your vows, and then you're thinking about Petra. So that's kind of interesting. So
yes,
you know,
it was. Actually, so, I was a half an hour away in Panormos, and I just got this urge to look at the bus schedule, and we had too many people for the car. So a couple of us graciously decided to let the older ones take the car ride, and we took the bus. And I thought maybe I should check in one last time and see if anything came through just in case. And of course it did. And I ran up the hill and here I am. So it's exciting.
Wonderful. So I think what we're going to do is we're going to get started with the show and make sure we get all our information. Of course, Amy, you can join us and provide some feedback if you like. But what we'll do is we're going to go into, we'll probably do Petra the second to last before Meetis.
Great.
So I think we're going to start off with Rhodan. Unless, JP, do you have anything else that you'd like to share?
Last night's show with Max was quite astounding, don't you think?
Yes, and I do want to address that because some of the information that comes up may have something to do with what happened last night.
Ooh.
All right, so maybe there's we should read... There is mystery, but you're going to see what I'm talking about.
Mm-hmm.
Because I did question and I was asking about it, and there were certain things that were standing out to me. And I have been looking for Thoth for a while. He's been hidden, and I finally understand why now. And then, of course, he came through last night, and he came through about 2 days before then.
Mm.
So I thought that was interesting, but... But yeah, it seems to be an interesting little parallel going between me and Max's show. I don't know what it is, but.
I remember when Max first heard this, he didn't believe, he was totally skeptical about this whole thing. He was like, there's a load of old trash. Yeah, and lots of people feel this, but it kind of grows on you and you gradually realize that it's just, you have to look at things from a slightly different perspective, and then everything drops into place and makes sense. So they say,
yeah. And I'm trying to keep, my mind is in all different places today, just trying to stay connected to what's going on and the information that I've been receiving. And, what I'm going to do is I'm going to open up Rhodan. It's Rhodan 32. So, and JP, do you have the document or...
The planet has moved into a new and uncharted direction. I'm pleased to say that we have safely and thoroughly removed Juno from the planetary field. It has been her attempt for thousands of years to alter the future of the planet, to gain ownership and full control of all related to this sector. Although we were aware of her efforts, as so many have made similar attempts, what concerned us is that she subtly integrated many areas undetected that we thought we would not be able to root her out, much like the behavior of a virus. She became a contagion like no other, until she would ultimately be on the mind of all living things, thus polluting their purpose, their inner selves, their own form, essence, and ultimately their connection to Source. She was intending to replace Source as the true origin of life under the guide of a mother goddess. It was a morsel of poison that would come in and fester, clinging even to the essence of breath and life. I know I had spoken to you about many other females from the earliest ones recorded in your history and the galactic regions above. We have spoken about Hera, Athena, Callisto, Artemis, Leto, and others. Besides Hera, none were more toxic than Juno. Juno made herself quietly beautiful, like a mist or a dream sneaking subtly into the thoughts and dreams of many. She took on many forms until she found one form that appeared universally beautiful, like a finely crafted jewel. She cut away at all of the imperfections until one was honed to appease the masses. Her personality was not important. It wasn't the beauty you imagined, the film star, the painted starlet, the glowing model, the vibrant seductress. It was the distant, unattainable beauty, fragile, seemingly barren, awaiting a protector, a valiant one to come and comfort her in his arms. She became the beauty, or seemingly a reflection of imagery in her mind, as if she was one and the same as the woman so she would not feel a detachment or threat by the image. A guardianess, a fairy, a frail, mystical beauty set carefully in the recess of the mind of all humanity. We searched and beheld her image in everyone, male, female, in every culture and race. Today, I remove this toxic beast from the imagery of humanity. She is now gone to haunt no one else again. That was the most laborious task of all. To uproot such an evil required thousands of years of research to find out what and how this was done. She multiplied herself similar to the model of a tree, the core of the tree, the branches, then more branches, and so on and so on. That image has finally been lifted. We were all sickened by what was to happen to humanity. She was guiding them to a cliff of extinction because of her misery and wicked intentions that were completely void of love. Barren, without emotion, she would have brought all humanity to a void that would have been irreparable for the soul. They would all turn to a vapor, wasting away through hunger, because she refused to feed her own body, and they would hear her. The gnawing at her stomach, the dryness without water, the bitterness without love, the rejection of a race who didn't receive her. Her need for her own brought her to Earth, where she came to feed upon their worship to sustain her existence. What else is left if she wanted nothing more? Her beauty was in vain. Or was she vain because of her beauty? All of this is one and the same. The worst part is all the innocents manipulated to believe that this was their love, their mother, themselves as if in a mirror. Their own truth, when all of it was a lie. I believe I have made my point to all sentient and non-sentient beings. The matter is now closed, and I find no other reason to request justification for this removal. Well, he's pissed.
Yes. I was surprised because he showed me. He said that it was almost like it was like a dream image that she projected in everyone's mind. And the personality that was similar to her was like in that movie Jupiter's Rising. Jupiter Ascending.
Ah, I see. Mila Kunitz.
Sister that, you know, brought herself, you remember she was taking the louche and to make herself beautiful?
Oh, yes.
The main character.
All right, the very thin aquiline woman, yeah.
The queen, one of the queens. Yeah, there was three of them, right?
The two brothers and the sisters. Yeah, okay, gotcha.
Yeah, yeah. So now to understand how this happened, we need to go to Andronicus.
Okay. I'm just getting the thing.
Hold on a second. I mean, all this sounds really harsh, but I mean, I know what he's talking about. I know exactly what he's talking about. It's sort of like this kind of dream-like energy in the background.
Neptunian. It's very the dream heart thing, isn't it?
Yeah, yeah. Okay.
Okay, so shall we, have we got the, are you ready to engage the time and space machine? I'm very near to you now, as I'm living on the planet you call Pluto. Can you see me? This is when I called out to you and told you you were there, well, that we were together before. You saw me. I had my hair with what you call dreadlocks. It's a tribal style for men on Pluto. You thought my eyes were Asian in appearance. Yes? Do you remember me still? Well, I'm not very far away, you know. The Sons of Thunder, Rhodan's children, live there as well, and often come to your planet. In some ways, the planet is a biosphere. We move about at times to avert catastrophic events. You may imagine it is very cold or barren in that sector, but we know how to adjust our environment for ourselves. So, you see, we can wormhole our way to you rather than simply and present an rather simply, and presents an optical illusion that we are so very far away. In fact, we are much closer than you can imagine. Tell me, would you come and see me if I invited you?
Of course I would. I would come to see you. Would you look the same as I saw you with the dreadlocks, or when I saw you on Andromeda?
Andromeda? When was I on Andromeda?
That's when we first met.
No, the first time we met was when I spoke to you before, as I look now.
Really? Are you different from Andronicus?
That's not really my name. And I don't know why you're calling me that.
What does your future look like?
Now is the future. That's what they say.
Yes, that is true. But there is an authentic future where events occur.
Yes, that is also true. I will search for this existence you call Andromeda. Oh, I see. A planet in the stars. It awakens me when I peer upon it. A wonderful paradise at the start. Yeah, then it turns bad, very bad. Oh, I die within myself there. Oh, wait, I survive. I want to know who's calling my name. It isn't you, it's someone else, a female, but she does not save me. She leaves me to die alone and finds another love.
Was that your wife?
Yeah, that is my wife now, Agara.
Tell me about her.
I have many children with her, and we live on Pluto.
Why doesn't she help you? Is she frightened or unable to help? Seemingly to be in shock over the future events, he closes his eyes to shut down the vision.
She doesn't love me. She never loved me. She doesn't care that I'm in trouble or anyone else. She wants to rule in my place.
Are you saying that she just wants to be a ruler?
Yes, and she takes in another by the name Dionysus, and he changes her name.
Say that again.
Oh, she takes in another by the name Dionysus, and he changes her name to Juno.
Does that mean that you were originally Jupiter?
Yes.
You didn't consider to look into the future before?
I'm watching her now on Pluto. She and Dionysus are arm in arm, embracing upon the pillows of my bed. I can also see them in the future, lying on a wooden floor with lightning bolts above them. My heart sinks to depths unimaginable. You see me. I am in shock, not knowing what to say.
Saturn is your father?
Yes, and he is alone. I don't know why. Something terrible has happened to me and those I loved. It's her, Juno, who does this to me. It's Dionysus who deceives me with his gentle demeanor and kind tongue. I would have never imagined their plot to destroy me. It saddens me so. I'm not myself. I want to see you, to talk by the embers of the fire. When will that be, and how can that be without causing you any danger? It appears all that I touch turns to wormwood.
Can you find out how this happens and return and change it to another outcome?
I will do that. The garden awaits me. So, another one of Andronicus's exes, huh?
Yes.
They get everywhere, don't they?
Well, I think we're getting to the root of the problem.
I hope so.
I think this was the one that before he didn't even remember. It was like, am I even talking to Andronicus? He didn't even remember. Like he came to me from another time space.
This is like he's under deep cover.
It's before he was on Andromeda.
Oh, right. So he's on Pluto before he's on Andromeda.
Yeah.
So do we know about the history of Andronicus, where he, you know, is he a Lyran?
He was Jupiter.
He was Jupiter.
He said he was Jupiter.
Yeah, and that's the same as Zeus, isn't it? So that still figures.
Yeah. But then he forgot who he was when he was on Andromeda. He keeps on going in and out of these phases where he doesn't remember who he was, or he can't deal with what happened.
Hmm. There's the grief.
I was a little, yeah, I was confused. I was confused and he was confused or couldn't deal with it or wanted to talk to me about it. Didn't like to see the betrayal that he saw. And Dionysus was supposed to be not very powerful, but carefully subtle in what he was doing. And then I guess what she does is then somehow uses the power of Jupiter to go into the integration and the thought, the mindset of humanity. So Agora and Juno is the same. And he said that Dionysus calls her Juno. She was Agora at first.
So this connects in with Rodan's report as well.
Yes, same one.
About Juno. You know what's really funny? You won't believe this, right? And this is so bizarre and abstract, but it all connects, right? I was watching a video today of... it's a brand new, it's just come out and it's a synthesizer, you know, it's an electronic musical keyboard called a synthesizer. And it's made by this German company called Behringer, who incidentally make the same, this is the mixing desk that we're talking through just as we speak. So it's the same company that makes this stuff. And it is, it's a remake of the 1980s Roland Juno synthesizer.
Mm.
And you know, all of these tunes that you remember from the 80s, that's the Juno, that's the sound of the Juno. So isn't it weird how this, and this video came out like today, they're talking about the sort of remaking this classic synthesizer. So
yeah, and in my book Macabre, I talk about Juno, and I didn't know why, I didn't know who it was. And you look at the mythology, that would have been the Roman mythology, because I don't know what her name was in Greece, but anyhow, Petra talks a little bit about her, and I could see her, I hate to say this, but she reminded me a lot of Semyase. So we get that image of Semyase sort of everywhere lately in the past 6 months or so.
Yeah, she keeps popping up, doesn't she?
Yeah.
As they say, like a bad penny. So, what about Amy? What do you think of these two transmissions? What's your impression?
Well, I think that hearing the pain of, you know, the infidelity, wouldn't that just break your heart? It just puts you in a whole totally different, you know, feeling when he has to experience that.
Yeah, and it's like the age old story of this whole, it's betrayal, it's about power, I keep on seeing that Jupiter ascending, and I'm starting to see now. So then very likely that the characters in that movie, if this was inspired, which I'm feeling it was, the characters would have been Juno as the female there, as the sister. I think that Juno was his sister then. Jupiter and Juno, brother and sister. I'd have to look it up. So it would have been him and her there in that movie, but who would be, and on my mind's going, well, who would be the other brother? If that they were trying to give that message. I don't know if you guys have any ideas on that, or even someone in the chat room.
Well, aren't they also representing Enki and Enlil?
I don't know.
And so who do they correspond with in our cosmogony?
It would be interesting to see who made the movie, what their intentions were, but I mean, it could be that they were making the movie off of something else, but to me it looks quite familiar, you know, from what is happening here. Mm. And, you know, there's that separation between the brother and the sister, and they don't particularly seem to like each other.
Well, they're reptilians, and you know they have their treachery. They all have this treachery and betrayal thing going on.
Right.
Who made it? Was the people who made the Matrix? Same people who made the Matrix and Cloud Atlas. The Wachowski siblings. They started out as two brothers. One had a sex change, and then the other had a sex change. So they're now the Wachowski sisters. Really, honest.
Okay. Well, anyway. I know that you know, a lot of the stuff came through, a lot of the information. I know that, you know, some of the ET information comes through the ACIO and somehow gets into the movie industry. So, but they can, you know, project that stuff, the stories into the minds of others, and very, very interesting. I just like if this is the story, you know, just curious to see if we could figure out who the other brother would be in that situation. But I'm not sure. Maybe I'm reaching.
Well, you know, there are so many possibilities with this as to where it's going, and you know, like. So, for instance, here's Andronicus, and he's what we'd call, you know, if you're in astrology, you say he's in a very Neptunian state. He doesn't know his ass from his elbow, as we say in Britain. He's very confused. And perhaps you're talking to an earlier version of Andronicus before he became the number and then re-became Andronicus or recreated himself as Andronicus.
Yeah. And maybe it's, I think he had a deliberate intention to forget so he could experience something new and fresh.
Yeah.
He doesn't do well with dealing with a problem or a crisis, kind of has his exit plans when something like that happens and then shuts it down. And maybe he can provide some kind of memory loss or, you know, I mean, technically we do that every time we incarnate. You know, imagine having to remember every single thing and then have one continuous life with all of its challenges and sorrows and, you know, deceptions and maybe there is something to be said about it's a good thing to forget so you can start afresh and maybe move on from it.
Well, sometimes we have an episode that makes us forget that we placed there deliberately in order for us to forget. As you say, so that we do the right thing, that we act in a spontaneous human way. And that's why it's taken us so long, because acting in a spontaneous human way is usually lashing out in violence up until now, until we're trying to, you know, we're pulling back that vibe and trying to advance a slightly less harmful one.
Right. So are we ready to hear what Petra has to say?
I think so.
Petra puts a last spin on it.
Okay, so let's engage the time machine. Hang on, everybody. Oh, buckle up.
Hello, child. I want to apologize for my misunderstandings about you. I know you meant no harm in your presence amongst us. Agora deceived us and did many things to harm you and wanted you to be blamed for many of the things she did. I heard your conversation with Andronicus and Rhodan. Don't be sad anymore. You will not be held in charge for some of the destruction to my people. How's the sound with that?
Perfect.
Okay, good. So this cloth works. Ha, I have a cloth over the microphone. Okay. My beloved people of Greece, it was Juno or Agora who betrayed you and created fear within our walls. They told me that Agora was a place for fear because of what Juno did, but I refused to believe it. She harmed many of my children with her cruelty. I'm so very sorry. I hear my children weep at night, wondering why such a beautiful nation is now struggling. All the surrounding lands are in pain. These are the things that some have done for power. I admit I have been guilty of it as well. Can we fix what has happened? And can we find healing for my children? Can we find peace? This whole time I've been asleep. Horrible things have happened to my land. Can we join together as friends, as sisters?
I would like that very much, Petra. I would like us to be friends. I would like to support Gaia as well. She is in so much pain also.
Let's join together in love. Let's teach our daughters to love one another. And instead of being competitive and jealous, let's teach our men to be kind and loving to us as well. Let's remind everyone that we are all family. Let's live in peace again, as we did in times past. I wish I was here sooner to speak with Juno before she became Agora. I spent very little time with her. Now we still have Callisto and Hera to speak to. Gaia is too wary to address it. For me, I feel strong and alive. I want to see the change. Will you join me?
Yes, Petra, of course. We can be sisters again.
Thank you, my dear. I will give you back your keys. They are yours forever.
What are the keys for?
You will see. It will help you bring more peace to the planet. Both Gaia and I agree you should be the one to stand in the gap. We both send you our support, but don't want to be caught in the crossfire. Gaia is very wary at this time. Let's keep her protected. We know they are all already speaking to you. There are many watching at this hour. Help me to remove the fear from Agora, and the whole planet will be prepared to deal with what is up ahead.
I looked it up, and this is where you get the name agoraphobia. It was because of the energy Juno brought to Greece?
Yes. She wanted to shift all the power to Rome, where she lived. This is how she did it.
Maybe we can remove it altogether. Where should this energy go?
Back to Hephaestus. How do you say that? Hephaestus?
Hephaestus.
Hephaestus. Back to Hephaestus. It was his to begin with.
Did he misuse this power?
Yes. And when they became lovers, he gave her the ability to use it as well.
Can we give it to Apollo so he can dissolve it and purify it in the sun?
I believe he will agree to that. You should know. You speak with him all the time.
I will ask. It is rising up like a transparent box. Rhodan is lifting it away. Our prayers for Greece right now. I'm seeing more Atlantean hybrids. They must be a part of this fear.
Yes, the tormented, unwelcome creatures on the planet.
Can we find peace for them as well?
Gaia was suggesting an island for them. It is a paradise to help them heal and feel loved.
I think that is a good idea. Can we send them there now?
I'll ask Gaia. She has a place prepared for them. 100 million of these beings etherically walk the planet. They have been multiplying and were getting very hostile. The island should accommodate them now. It is elsewhere, other dimensionally. I won't say where in the event that some may attempt to destroy them. They merely want to enjoy their experience before they join other societies in another incarnation.
Well, that's wonderful.
Thank you, dear one. We shall be in peace with one another.
Thank you, Petra.
Wow.
Hmm. So that was a very nice conversation I had with Petra.
Two goddesses together.
Yeah. Well, for those that haven't heard the background of Petra, she was Pyra in the works of Ovid. And, you know, at first when she had awakened from stasis, she was reacting, seeing that things were in disarray, and had a little bit of a conflict with her. She brought in Gaia, and she had a conflict with Gaia, and she began to further research and see what was actually going on, and realized that there were other things happening. And so she wanted to apologize and also to, you know, open communication about the topic. And so that's how it transpired. And of course, Amy, you did a wonderful job. And the kind of presence that Petra has is, you know, very, very similar to your personality. And it's, you know, kind of strong and affirmative, but loving. So thank you for doing that.
Thank you.
And even coming directly from Greece.
Yeah, what a coincidence.
Yes.
Yeah, it's that Mediterranean flavor. You can smell the olive oil.
Yes. Yes. What's so lovely is they have quite a bunch of trees for lemons. And, like, I think the people really know how to, you know, they know how to have gardens in their own properties that provide all these plants and beautiful olives and fruits. And it's just really wonderful to be here to see this.
Well, that's interesting that you said that, because the old world culture, you know, never forgot that they were supposed to be growing their own gardens and having this food available to them outside their homes. And that's something that we forgot to do. We got so caught up in, you know, corporations and manufacturing and supermarkets that we forgot to take care of our basic needs right outside our door. And we're gonna talk to Larry Buell about that coming up soon. So that's great that you brought that up. And I imagine it's quite beautiful there.
Yes. Yes, it's very beautiful, and the people are very warm, and I think they really want, you know, their tourism, of course, to help out the economy, but they really go the extra mile in helping you feel very welcomed and accommodated, and, you know, I've had wonderful meals here, and I just think it's a beautiful place to visit.
And a beautiful place to renew your vows.
Yes. That is that's very special. I mean, I just can't be happier to have had that opportunity to come. And I have a really good friend who is Greek in Boston. He suggested we try Greece, and to him, it just made all the difference in the world that we traveled somewhere new, because we always usually go back to see the in-laws, right? But when you go to see the in-laws, my rule is it's not really a vacation when you have to go see the in-laws, even though it's a lovely place.
Well, you sort of had your big fat Greek wedding.
Well, it happened to be that when we were having our reception, we saw all these pictures on the wall of the Mamma Mia cast. And it turned out that they had actually stayed on Skopelos in this very lovely hotel right where we were celebrating our reception meal. And all of the cast had posed with pictures with their staff. And they said they really had, you know, a lot of fun. They were very nice, and they partied all night long. So I thought that was really great that they had a good time. And of course, this is known as the Mamma Mia Island.
Did you break any dishes?
No, I don't know where that comes from. Maybe somebody in the chat would comment on that, if that's a real tradition.
Real tradition, but I don't know for what reason.
Okay.
That they do that. I heard that they do that during weddings.
Okay, that's interesting.
There's an old Jewish tradition during weddings of breaking a glass, so it may be a Mediterranean thing. Maybe it's Egyptian. Mm. Who knows?
Yeah, who knows? But, that's awesome. So, we're not quite finished yet. JP, we still have Meetis, and unfortunately, he didn't give me a song.
Oh, that's fine. We're coming up to the top of the hour, so should we do a song now? I need to visit the bathroom and do yes. some stuff. So let's have some Eric Clapton, because we love Eric Clapton, don't we? And
yes, and is it possible to play that song that who was it that made a song for Meetis song for us?
Oh, that one, the Meetis 20. I wonder yes. where that is. Good question.
If you can maybe find that, and after the Meetis transmission, maybe we can play that.
Yeah. Okay. Because it was a real Tom Jones kind of number. I remember. Anyway, so here's some Eric Clapton in the meantime.
That's awesome.
Here's Mo.
Okay.
Yeah. And as the cheers die away.
Yes.
A change of the guard.
Yes.
A change of the guard. Yes.
Amy has left. She's joining her family for dinner. And I asked her to break a dish or two. And she said, yes, I will toast you both and Wolf Spirit family, Wolf Spirit Radio family as well. So that was nice. And
so I'm just grabbing your friend's telephone number here.
So yeah, we can bring him in
later on.
Let's read Meetis. Yeah. Yeah, let's bring in Meetis, because as soon as we start talking, we may not get a chance to finish up, and let's finish up first.
So, where's the Meetis theme? Hang on, here we go. Oh, hello, my love. They sent me away again. I know they're up to something when they send me away. So I snuck back in. I'm on the countryside of Devonshire. I can't say what time and place, but I'm putting all the protections in the land again. I bet you thought all those structures and strange images, circles and the like, are by accident. It's a warning to others not to harm my home. This is my home, you know. And I won't allow it to be harmed. I know that what they're up to. They will have to go through me if they want anything destructive to the jolly old England or the Isle itself. I am courting the idea of taking on more responsibility. Rhodan is equipping me with all that I need. It will be an explosion for sure. Fireworks and all if they dare cross me.
Meetis, what is going on? They threatened me today saying that they would harm the planet. Is this the Egyptians doing it? The ones from Sirius?
Oh, no, that's what they would like you to believe. That's the reason why Toph was aloof and hidden from you. He thought you believed them.
Who are they, then?
The Sirius friends have been here to assist humanity throughout the ages. I don't want to say or tell you or have you tell others so you are more in danger than you need to be. I know who they are, and I don't have fear.
Does it have to do with Juno? She seems to be the topic of the day.
In a way, yes. I see her as a problem. She seems to be getting everybody rallied for warfare at a whim. There's a very sensitive topic for Andronicus. Before you, there was Juno. She was to be his perfect mate. Juno and Jupiter. Jove. That's where the love come from. That's where the word love comes from. Jove. Not anymore. He was reawakened by the heartache of what happened, and he is a different type of ill now. Not in a very good place, I might add.
Is this the reason why he acted as if he didn't know me?
Don't take it personal, love. He's not himself, and he's awaking to the realization of what happened or will happen. You're the one who told him without realizing it. Thus, your karma. He leaves his relationship that is steeped in lies. She retains the powers and abuses it. So many suffer. He then pulls you into his reality at a whim, while you are to be traveling along on your own path. So many disruptions. So much journeying. So much confusion. So much sorrow. I said, take my word for it, Andronicus. Running from your sorrows will never cure them. He's looking for solace. We knew he would be searching for you.
I can't say what he said to me. It was a reflection of deep unhappiness.
We know, and we hoped you would help him. It will help everyone to be at peace. I'm preparing now. I don't want anyone to know the details of what I'm doing. But I heard what was said last night, just as you did. I have my troops beside me, and there will be much to say whenever they arrive.
Is it the crustaceans, the ones that we talked about before?
Oh, no. You took care of them and calmed them down. There's something else that needs fully to be revealed. We don't want anyone innocent being affected by it. I will stay by your side and protect your field as well. My people in Australia, Africa, and New Zealand will feel me. My brethren and sisters, I love you dearly. Go now. Be strong. Wow. Not even Meetis is cheerful this week. Bloody hell. Is this, tying in with all this was what happened on Max's show last night. So we
Well, it sort of opened up something when Toth came out.
Yeah.
He allowed the information to be revealed.
Yeah. So let's just recap. Max was having some healing crisis, right? Nicole, this is during Max's show last night. If anybody missed it, you can check it out. It's a great show. I played it just before this one. His guest was, Joanna, the medium from, British Columbia. And, she thought she was just going to do a couple of innocent readings. Ha ha ha. But she didn't know about the kind of beings that hang around us. Anyway, so I said to her, oh, you got any messages from my guides then? And she starts describing this huge creature. Can you remember what were you seeing? Were you seeing anything there at that moment?
Well, because she stepped into your field and then she saw you as she remembered you, and both of you had a common connection to Todd and knew each other at that time. And so she saw you, remembered you, and then started to see Todd, and then didn't know how to take it and was concerned that we would think she was weird or whatever. And
we comforted her.
Yeah, we comforted her in letting her know that you did in particular, let her know that, this is what we deal with regularly. And so I said, well, there was a woman that told me she was, she was connected to Toth and, was very honed in on me just 2 days before. So now here she has this clear image of Toth and doesn't know what to think because it's a half, humanoid looking body, extremely tall and thin. And then a head that is not human-looking. And then she had to look it up, and she confirmed that that was what Toth looked like, or the, image of that he wanted to reveal himself as. So then she goes on to give you a message, and then she mentions a war. And she mentioned other things, too, that were very interesting.
Many other things. So shall I read the reading of what Toth said, since I read things?
Yes.
Shall I read this out? So the first line is, this is your connection to Egypt, my dear, and you both are messengers of God, and spread the word as fast as you can. So I think YouTube does the job. so the message reads, this is only the beginning. Life isn't forever, but the message is. It is God we seek, not the devil we dwell in. You will understand what this all means in time. Wars are not to be won, but to be conquered and be freed from. For now, The message is for you to understand that love and love alone is the only force that will save this world. Do not forget where you come from, for this is the only path that you will follow. This is the only path that you will follow into your existence of the forever after. Listen to your heart, for your mind can often escape you. But do not forget that you are also a human too. It is form that you were given for a purpose, to achieve aspects within yourself that sometimes feel insurmountable to you. Yet remember, the bridge that you are about to cross is one that will forever shape your entire existence from this time forward. Do not be afraid, for fear is only in your imagination. It is not implied that fear and fear itself does not impose a negative aspect into your soul, but remember, love can overcome anything that is and stands in front of you at this particular time. And this includes the wars that are about to unfold in front of your eyes. Be patient, for patience is the only way at this particular time to allow your body and mind to coexist at this time of chaos. Be proud, for you have chosen to come into this existence in order to accomplish acts of kindness based on love and love alone. So that's the message.
That's what Joanna's, Joanna transmitted that information from Toth to you last night.
Yeah. And it was, I mean, it had me in tears when I was hearing it. And I have a friend who's performing in a festival this weekend. And she just passed by this afternoon. And I said, you got to hear this. And I read this out to her, and because she's doing a performance this week that is all about like love from the heart and stuff like this. It's all just kind of condensing the teachings into an entertainment. She's brilliant. And you know, I think she'll maybe use some of this energy. So
yeah,
it's going out.
That's good.
It's going out live to hundreds of people. So that's good.
I had a friend reach out to me, and he said that, there's another friend that he knows is having upper respiratory issues. And then he mentioned something about the Akashic Records, and he didn't listen to the show last night. And I said, well, Max Steele said that he was having upper respiratory issues. And her message to me was about the Akashic Records and how it's going to be really opening up even more than it is already. And that she saw me having someone help me in transcribing some of the information. Because she said that when you're typing it, it's hard to write down some of the information that's flowing through because, I explained to her, it's you're thinking of grammar. You're thinking, does this make any sense? And you're just sort of, that there's that other part of your brain that has to be in play as you're typing the stuff down so that you can go back and read it and it has some coherency to it. Because some of the stuff when I'm opening up, it's imagery and other things that are really hard to describe in words. I have to find the right words, and I have to stop and think about, what is the term for that, and some of those details. So then she mentioned wars to me as well. And from my perspective, and JP, you can correct me if you think that it's otherwise, but I felt like Toth was assisting her with both of messages for the both of us.
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. I mean, it says you both are messengers of God. Like, who's he talking to? Well, all of us, actually. But, both of us. That's the first thing he said. You're both messengers of God. Spread the word as fast as you can. And this is only the beginning.
Mm-hmm.
And when I heard that line, this is only the beginning. I saw this enormous, well, you know, what we imagine, you know, what we've kind of been playing around with, like, wouldn't it be cool if there was a TV show or something like that? Or there were books. You know, you're already planning making books. And then she said, yes, there's two more books coming. Didn't she?
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So, yeah, I was thinking that it might have been the Andronicus transmissions that I was going to put together, but maybe not. I don't know. But I'm supposed to spend some time in gathering the data. I do have the second book of the Seer that's just about ready, but I haven't had a chance to really spend time in editing it. I don't know. I don't know. I do feel like today was a very hard day for me. I felt like I heard some information I didn't want to hear. And I don't want to get into it any further. Other than, you know, of course, the transmission of this information about Juno was upsetting as well, because so many of the females, I don't know why, they kind of got into the interplay of power as well. And you know, the male and female equally alike, and those that had points of power were also, you know, equally guilty and equally responsible for both good and bad on the planet. So I can't say one is better than the other. You know, clearly there's a lot of different issues of things going on. So, maybe can we play that music of Meetis right now?
Oh,
and
right,
we'll prepare
yeah.
for...
Yeah.
If you can't find it.
Maybe you could introduce it while I dig somewhere. Where the heck did I leave it? I'll just have a quick look. So, do you want to describe... Yeah, well, it's as you say, it's been quite quite an intense moment. I'm pretty tired, I have to say, because Colleen has been off for quite a few days now, and I've been kind of holding the station up. And my system has been malfunctioning. So what I really need is a day of downtime when I'm not doing anything, and so I can focus on fixing the computer and not run a radio station.
it's like the big train, isn't it?
Yeah, it does feel like, it's like a train or a ship that you really can't stop. You know, it's just, it keeps going, and there's nothing that can, get in its way, you know, not even your life.
Yeah. so we're looking for sound engineers and people that are interested in doing that remotely, right? To connect into someone that is, interested in taking that role. That should have been one of the top of the hour requests. And of course, you know, sending money as well and supporting the network is another great thing.
Yeah, but really, I mean, the money's great and it's coming in. There's a nice balance. You know, we've got a good flow, and the money's good, but it's the personnel, really. We need more producers because, look, it's really quite a challenging thing. And if you feel like a challenge, you really want to, you know, take on a challenge that really means you don't have to move very far. You know, if you're that sort of, you know, got that sort of aptitude, you've got an excitement about learning and speaking or hearing people speak and learning from them, as Colleen and I have, if you've got that sort of level of curiosity and that level of, you know, understanding of between technical and audio. Mm-hmm. If you can, it is kind of like if you know a musician who's a truther, that's the kind of person we're looking for. Somebody who makes recordings. Yeah.
Absolutely. All right. So we want to open up to that, and you know, we're going to ask the universe to provide the right people, and we're not going to just ask for one sound engineer, but maybe a couple of them, so that you guys can just, you know, JP can, it's very, very much appreciated, all the work that you do to provide intel and all sorts of insights and information that's coming through in depths of spirituality coming through the network. But if you know, you're only one person, you can't do it all by yourself, and there's so many talented people out there, and I, some people that just would love to be a part of what's going on.
Oh, yeah,
and,
I hope so, yeah.
There's a wonderful opportunity to do that, you know, and you want to have a voice. Well, you know, a lot of times in the shows, the sound engineer, you know, participates in the shows. So, you know, consider, you know, join the group, and it doesn't, you know, you just take on what you can take on. But it would be very much appreciated. And of course you'd be joining the Wolf Pack as well. So just something to think about.
Well, I'm running the search on my computer. I haven't got it yet. It's finding everything that is called Meetis. And so it's now ground to a halt. So yeah, I know. So, so this week has been, a week of system failures, you know, but I think, you know, in addition, my body has gone like, I had a terrible time over the weekend. It felt like, you know, somebody had kind of taken a kind of a clockwork key and, plugged it into my spine and kind of going, and mm-hmm. wound it all the way up. It was like my body was so, like what they say, racked with tension, you know, and there was nothing. It was like a maybe a poison or something like that, maybe chemtrails. I'm not sure what it was really all about, but it's only just going away.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and you know, maybe things will reset itself. I know you've had some technical problems, but just like mm-hmm. anything that usually is challenging the network, it seems to come and go. I don't think that they usually have any long stay or resilience in that effort. You know, because, you know, the primary theme behind the network is love, and there's nothing more powerful than love and truth. And, you continue on in that effort.
Yep.
And so, you know, I encourage people to, you know, we all have our challenges, but there's something there that sustains us, and that's our knowing that we're affecting and helping others. And I always appreciate when people send me a little message saying, hey, you know, you inspired me to connect with my family. Or you inspired me, you know, thank you so much for, you know, doing the work that you're doing. And I've had so much positive feedback that, you know, in the beginning, I thought that would be just the opposite. People might be, you know, angry about information or even mocking what I'm doing. And I'm grateful that it had the right people are listening. And I'm sure that there are people thinking that this is nonsense. But, you know, so is a lot of things. You know, you just gravitate toward what is interesting to you. And if this is not for you, that's fine. There's a lot of other things to listen to. And, it's a big world with lots of perspectives. So, you know, go towards what you gravitate with.
Yeah, indeed.
And yeah.
So, I found one thing, which is not what we were looking for, but it was one thing. It was, Meetis's Ode to Hera. I clipped out somehow. So I've got that in a file. So, let's put that one on for the moment.
Okay.
Yeah. And,
And then we'll bring in Larry.
And we'll go and get Larry. So let me just drop that onto the desktop on Harry Potter. Harry Potter is the name of this computer that is crashing today. So
poor Harry Potter.
It's because it's a Hewlett Packard HP. So
yeah.
HP is Harry Potter. Yeah. Anyway, so here we go. Ode to Hera.
My French poodle from the stars, I will love you and kiss you, then toss you very far, kicked you to the curb, then you never will want to disturb the many people on the planet and the chosen children who serve. Farewell, my false Isis. Farewell, my fraudulent queen. Farewell, my heart of envy, 'cause you never cease to destroy what you see. Farewell, my girl next door, who is there to destroy men more. Farewell, well raven beauty with an anger bitter rapport.
Okay. Yes. Hello, Larry.
Well,
how are you?
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. This is Larry Buell from Petersham, Massachusetts, on the east coast of North America. And I give thanks to Spirit Radio in the work that you're doing to share the wisdom and the teachings to all those around the world. So I give great thanks. And it's a great with gratitude that I join you this afternoon. So thank you.
So, Larry, it was an honor to meet you this week. You are doing wonderful work there on Earthlands. That's the name of the land that you've devoted to all humanity. And, or maybe you can rephrase that however you like, but that was my perception of it.
Right. Yes. And, I'd like to give give you a little overview because, as you know, with the transition that's happening on the planet, these centers are happening all around the world. And we just happen to be one part of this, sort of a cosmic, network that's happening around the world. So I, will give you a little overview of how it came because I think we need to model and see how others are doing it because we can learn a little snippet because we're all in this together and it feels, quite good. So, I would like to start. I've grew up on a farm, so I'm sort of what they call a straddler. I grew up in the dirt farm, but then I got my doctorate and went on for about 50 years of teaching in higher education. And my real career in this work of earth-based work started in March 21st of 1964 when I received a vision basically from the Green Man who introduced me to Spinoza. And Spinoza is the philosopher of pantheism, that all life is connected. So my entire adult career and personal life has been dedicated to making that unfold. And growing up on the farm, I was able to do that pretty easily. And yet, and doing that, I was also encountered some of the challenges in higher education. So what I did in 1987, I created a living and learning center at a place called Earthlands. We originally had about 500 acres. We now have about 250 acres have been already preserved and will never be developed. And that's around it. And we're in a place of about 4,000 acres near the Quabbin Reservoir, which is the water source for all of the city of Boston. So in 1993, we came together for 16 weeks with about 15 students, and we had a living and learning community there. And but that in itself wasn't enough. So I was guided by spirit to go to Siberia. And in the fall of 1991, I was in Siberia, and there the 10 principles of Earthlands came to me. And those principles are pretty well, you know, guiding us on how to live on the planet. And for example, the first one is daily endeavors, which many have heard. Dostoevsky in Russia came up with, let's live our life in four ways: bread labor, community contribution, creative endeavor, and personal maintenance. And it's kind of interesting. If we could live our life in those balanced ways, we might find that, we too would live more in balance. So from that time in Siberia, where also it's interesting, the name of your radio, Spirit Radio, is that I was introduced to the wolves at Lake Baikal, and they've been my teachers before and after. And from then, I came back and founded the Earthlands community in 1993. So that's the start of it. And then in 1987, we divided into two groups. One group wanted to just live in community, modeled on some of the intentional community models that were around, like Finhorn and some of the others. And then some of us wanted to live both in a community, but also have a healing and education center. So thus, we had two centers on that land. The community group left to start communities other places around the country. But during the Y2K period, year 2000, I wrote an article for the Communities magazine, and the last line of that, it was a sort of a, the focus was the covenant with the earth, no matter what would happen during Y2K when the digital world was supposed to stop working. And we know it didn't, but it was a good wake-up call. The last line in that article, it said, in the future, we will be going to the Cathedral of the Pines and the University of the Wild. And that word, University of the Wild, has been my focus for the last 16 years in creating a place where people can be involved in self-directed learning under mentorship and with experiential-based. So that brought us to the present, and that's the very short, you know, short development of what we did. And now we have, we basically have five programs that we're working very closely with. And I'll just give those a snippet, and then if there's any questions, then we'll go on and get a little more depth to it. So the five programs that are happening on this amazing land that we are on, the first of all, it is Nipmuc land, which is the, they're of the Algonquian language group, and they have lived on this land for 8,000 years, and they are invited back and coming back because this originally was their land, and they're involved in Earthlands to the point that David Tallpine White, who's a language keeper, we are transferring some of this original land back to them so they can create a teaching, a cultural teaching center, both for Nipmucs, Native Americans, and non-natives. And this will be part of the curriculum for what I mentioned with the University of the Wild. And then the four other programs is a program center of healing and education. The collective, we have a collective which is looking at alternative businesses because I believe we need to start to look at alternative ways to govern, such as sociocracy and business and currency, such as our credits. And living in community. That's such, those are very, very important skills and abilities now. And all this land will be held under a community land trust. It'll be different from a conservation land trust. Community land trusts are where people can create, will build their own homes on this land, but the land will be owned in land trust. Certain parts of it certainly will be held, and there'll be an eco-village there. And so, we're focusing on programs and services for people of all ages and circumstances to live and learn in connection, harmony with the earth and all life. And we'll talk about the future, but that's a little snippet of what we're doing at Earthlands. And we're an international center, so we have a tremendous number of folks. We have a chap from Australia with us right now that has come and is setting his own education center down under. And we've been had hundreds of people here in the last few days sort of envisioning what the future will look like. Well, I'll just stop for a moment there and just see if there's any particular questions, and then we'll go on. But this is very exciting to be able to share this work with you.
That's wonderful. And, you know, I'm really excited because JP's located by Findhorn, and I got to spend time there at Earthlands. And it's nice to be able to bridge the gap today. And I don't know, JP, if you had any questions.
Well, here I am. I've lived 10 miles from Findhorn, and I'm about the same age as Findhorn. They started just the, kind of when I was two or something. So there's this thing, and there's a, you know, I know a load of people who like were literally born here, and grew up in that community, and they're great. I love being around them because they're all switched on, and it's the kind of community, oh, now where do I go with that? It's a long story, but there's a lot of spiritual people that need to be housed in this planet. People who, because of how things used to be, they can't be incarnated into like regular old-fashioned parents because they would damage them. They need to be enlightened parenting. And this is the is why there's all these different places all over the world like you're talking about. Like yours and in Findhorn and Aurobindo and all these places, Oroville, they're going to be the beacons. They're going to be the new pyramids. People are going to start creating civilizations around them. So that's what's going on for me around here.
Yeah. And I think as you're absolutely right, JP, that there are going to be, we need models. And I know that one of our sister communities is serious in, Shrewsbury, Mass. And, of course, they were founded pretty much through the Findhorn principles and came here and created that. So, and I've read, you know, we've read Dorothy McLean's autobiography, and so we know. And we also know the challenge that people who strike out with a vision, they sometimes have to leave everything. And we know that in the radical times, we have to be ready to lose everything, our careers, our even maybe our families, and for some, their lives. So we are at that choice point of which this is going to be happening. And that's part of what, when we think of the future and earthlings and all these, there will need three things. We need to have learning and living centers to learn the new skills and abilities, like transition towns. Secondly, we need demonstration models where people can come and see, actually get hands-on on how this is done, like with woofers, willing workers on organic farms. And then an international network where we connect people together, because what we're finding is that there's a lot of isolation and lack of connection and people feeling lonely and don't know. But as soon as you gather these circles together, these tribal clan gathers together, it's amazing what can happen. So that is absolutely, absolutely true.
And I think that, well, we're learning from each other, and people will say, you know, like, well, what's the purpose? Why do something like that? Or it's very hippie. Like, and I think that the technological generations that are coming up, a lot of these kids don't even step outside. I mean, the neighborhoods got to a point where people were afraid of children being abducted. They were afraid of, you know, letting them just play out in the neighborhood. You know, kids going into the woods, so you have to worry about getting Lyme's disease. I mean, all these horrible things, and it's like, oh my gosh, this is, it's so away from nature. I mean, how did this get designed? Right. What is happening here? And if something happened and say our electricity went down, the national grid went down, or, you know, for some reason that we don't have access to a food source or whatever, can anyone, how much of the population can survive? Do we know how to grow our own foods? I'm not to say to bring on fear, but let's be reasonable and let's default back to how do we survive in the natural way, because we're being pulled away from what is natural. Now, technology is good, but not to replace that we are earth beings. We are here on the planet and we need to eat natural organic foods that come from the mother. And just to return back, that's the reason why why places like this are opened up, because they're recognizing this. Is that true? Is that how you feel, Larry?
Exactly. And what's happening is that the teachers and the wisdom carriers from these places will go out into the communities. For example, this evening at 5 o'clock, we have 30 people from our own community coming to have a walkabout to find edible wild plants, and we'll harvest some of those plants and bring them to our meal, which we'll have at 7 o'clock. So that's exactly what is happening. Also, the research shows we have to look. I'm a deep ecologist, which means that you keep looking at the deeper questions. And so why have we got connected? We're not going to go into that deeply now, but that must be looked at. And part of it is this disconnect that's happened. But the research is called The Last Child in the Woods, and partly when you get separated from the wild and from the natural within ourselves and around us, then we see what's happening here. And there's a law of ecology that is very rarely taught in colleges or schools, and that has that the organism mirrors her surroundings. So if you live in a cement bunker, or if you live around criticism, that's what you will become. So what our goal is, and all those who are on the radio today, we are creating places of joy, of beauty, where love and well-being are the main focus. And people are coming to these centers. People are ready to learn. So I will not, and I've made a commitment in my, you know, I'm 73 right now, and I commit that I'm not going to be around the negative people. I'm going to be in how we propose the future. In fact, Derek Jensen says, there's no such thing as hope, only action. And I believe there's some truth to there. And we're going to act, and Gary Snyder says, one day we all must make a stand. And I believe that that's what we're doing. And we each have to find our commitment and what we are going to give to our work on the planet. Absolutely.
Yeah. That's beautiful, Larry. Yeah. I just, you know, it shouldn't have gone to this level, and somewhere there was a disconnect, but that's okay because I think we're picking up the pieces now. Some of the other outreaches that you're working with that I gained knowledge from during sitting around in your group, which you were highly welcoming for me being an outsider. I was able to come in and just feel like I was a part, as if I'd always been a part of the group. Right. And you know, even some of the decision making, you were, you know, open to even hearing what I had to say, and very honored by that. But I felt like there wasn't really a whole lot for me to contribute, because it felt like you guys really knew exactly what you wanted and were already, you know, moving forward in that direction, which was highly positive.
Yeah.
So my thoughts were is that let's have more of this. Let's share this with everyone. But one of the outreaches that you're working on is to the younger generations. Mm-hmm. You're preparing festivals.
Right. Exactly.
Tell us about that.
Yeah, we've had a number of festivals at Earthlands where sometimes several hundred people come. And one was a forest dance where it's trance dancing, where you dance from midnight till dawn 4 days in a row and have maybe 30 drummers helping guide there. We've had a SWID, Sacred World Interdependence Day. And what we're moving towards now is called the Future is Now Festival. And this is where we demonstrate and show the very best of new technologies, plus music and dance, because it's not just about content. We must get into some of the creative arts, as Matthew Fox says. The future is going to be in the hands of the artists. And I think we have to become more creative within ourselves. So that's certainly one of our approach. We're also working. We have a project connected to Project Urban Earth, because we must connect to the urban population. So one of our initiatives is a Hanging Gardens project in the city of Providence in Rhode Island. And that is where we will grow good organic food within some of the fallen down factories that have been vacated. So that's another one of our projects. And the other really important work for us to do is our own personal deep work. This is called our own practice. And because many people do not have a practice. And when you study the human being, you'll know there's three things that you can suffer, even leave this life. It's because of diet, exercise, or stress. And in my case, I've got my diet. I've been a vegan for about 25 years. I've got my diet under control, and my exercise, I do that hour, at least an hour. I'm working in the fields, and I'm out. And my work on stress is being reduced. But some of the deeper work that we have to do on ourselves, and I think these creative groups are coming together, but we're so encultured by a society which is dominated by the patriarch. We must do some deep, deep work about overriding some of these conditionings that have come. And it's ancestral, as you know. This is not something that just happened this generation. In my case, you know, I'm looking back at many, many generations and working with my grandsons to override that. And you can't, you know, you don't have to sit down and say, well, we're going to do this. But you try to learn the story of your family and how they dealt with different situations that have come up. So I believe that the deep personal work, and I love that they say this statement, particularly to the college students, which is my priority. There's only two questions to ask. Where are you going and who are you going with? And never ask them in reverse, because we must find out what our path is and then give our path, as Black Elk says, to our people. So that's the focus. So we do a lot of we do discharge work. We do, you know, shadow work. But it's not the dominant thing, because we're not going to only stay stuck in the story. We have to change. But how do we acknowledge that and move on to what our gifts are? Yes.
Excellent. Yeah. JP.
Yes.
Yeah.
Have I found anything yet?
Well, you know, I mean, you're a musician. You were participating in a lot of things, and you were in the community with Maitreya, weren't you?
In Glastonbury, I lived there, and we did some stuff. I made some pyramids.
Yeah.
We made some Leviton generators and stuff like that.
Okay.
That was fascinating. Yeah. Right. So, well, you know, I've been doing stuff with some people at Findhorn, but really at Findhorn, it's like, A lot of the energy of Glastonbury is kind of more youthful, let's put it that way, a little more energetic, and Vindorn's a little more cerebral, if you like.
Yes, yeah.
But it has gone the way of a lot of the world in that they have bank connections and stuff like that, and so they're having to raise money to pay interest on debts, and so there's a little less of the spiritual as there used to be. But what's happened is that that has now spread to the what is now known as the wider community, which is like what I am.
It's
all spread out, and we all have our little domains.
Yes, yeah.
And that's what's happened. Is you know, so we're generating that. Yeah. It's the next generation.
Yeah, absolutely. So we have, you know, we have one foot in that world, and we realize that there can be another way, because if we get, I mean, the research shows that it takes about 3 to 5% of the people to really make the goods and services that we need in order to live, as long as we're growing our own food, which is both an exercise of food production and connection to the earth. But in my work is to try to get people reconnected. And one way to do that is to get people for at least 3 days out into the wild. Rudyard Kipling, who wrote Jungle Book right here, very near Earthlands, said this very important statement. He says, the heathen is but 3 days from the trailhead. And the heathen is by the Christian perspective is a very evil thing. But from the native perspective, it's one totally aligned with their surroundings. So if we could all become more wild and more heathen, we would then connect to the energy, because we're starting to learn. Science is teaching us the connection we have to the very trees that we have in our yards, and the trees are connected to all the other plants and animals that are around. So this is the lessons that have been lost, you know, as soon as civilization, and particularly our industrial civilization, took over. These were subjugated, and now with the Wiccas and some of the other earth-based spiritual practices, we're starting to learn that, wow, we can get back, and we don't have to leave behind some of the things that our culture has created, because there's been some very, very great benefits, but we know we have to change as well.
And you know, provide a place, a location where people can delve themselves into this and learn and spread the word and kind of get out there and share with other people some of these concepts. You know, you spend this many years collecting information of what works, what doesn't work, and a lot of it's trial and error. And so many are trying to just, you know, keep the space going so something like this can exist.
Exactly.
How do people get in touch with you if they want to participate, if they want to get involved with a workshop or to even provide support financially or in any way?
Exactly. Well, we have a website, a very easy to access website called www.earthlands.org. You can go there, and a lot of the information is there. And we invite people to come and be at Earthlands. We have programs that are ongoing, you know, throughout. We have an indigenous elder from Ecuador coming, Nana Wilma, who is carrying the staff of about 100,000 women around the world. She'll be there next week. So there's much, much happening. We also have this agreement. If people want to come and be at Earthlands and contribute and see how things are going, we have this agreement that they can work for 3 hours, and in return, they get a place to stay. They provide their own food or make a donation to our food. But that's a way that people can serve. We kid, if someone wants to live there the rest of their life, then we have to consent on that. But we have the principle of 3-3-3, 3 minutes, 3 hours, 3 days, 3 weeks, 3 months. And each of those threes, we look at each other and say, is it working? Am I sharing? Am I getting something from it? And both Earthlands and the person, the guest, will say that. And that's been a good practice for us, you know, to get people. But yes, we're looking for connections, and you're going to see we're on the verge of getting some very, very wonderful capital to come in and help our concept move forward. We're working with local colleges, Goddard College in Vermont, Clark University, and a few other mainstream colleges. Yeah.
Very nice. It looks like, is it a question from the chat room, JP?
Yes, indeed. It's come through Skype, but it's from Serena. Can you ask him? Well, can I ask you, Larry?
Yeah.
What's your surname as well, Larry?
Yes, it's Larry. Larry Buell.
Buell. How do you spell that?
Buell. B-L-L. William Buell, 1606, came over from England.
Yeah. How do you spell
how
it?
Do you spell I your know, last right? name? It's B-U-E-L-L. Is that correct?
Yeah, that's right. Yep.
Okay. Yes. All right. So can you ask, Larry, how one who has no money but all the spirit, beauty, and the integrity of the natural spirit of love be a part of what you're talking about, be a part of this?
In order to be a part of our community and other communities similar to this, you do not have to have capital, but you have to have a gift to give, and you have to develop that gift. We have people who now receive a small type stipend all the way from $50 plus a house to something more than that. We it is not based on finances to come there. We obviously, if everybody came and we, you know, we have to have a sustainable base, but the same sustainable base will work where people have those skills. We need there's no need, but we are inviting grant writers, we're inviting cooks, we're inviting gardeners, we're inviting visionaries, we're inviting all these people. And so there is a way for people to get involved in Earthlands and not to have to come and pay an upfront money. But there's an interesting, when you say that, people who have not been able to have enough resources to support themselves, this is not including artists, because we know that artists sometimes have to become supported by the culture. But people who have not been able to create enough to even sustain themselves and come into a place like Earthlands, they haven't done some of the healing, because we have, and this is the challenge of many, many communities, that people come up the road and say, if I can just get a job, if I can just live in this community, life is fine. And they have not done that deeper personal work that I've mentioned. So that's why we invite people to come. We will, you know, have you be in community, and we'll know, and you'll know, and there may be somebody in our community that can give you feedback on what you need to do. And it could happen at Earthlands or one of the other places. And it, our program may not be aligned with exactly what you will be needing. But there is, certainly at Earthlands, you do not need capital to come into the circle, but you will have a gift that we desire in our circle.
Where does Serena live? Do you know, JP?
Hang on. It's 1500 where she is, so Eastern, I believe. And okay. She says, "Oh my God!" She says, "Oh my God! He needs me. I'm a gardener amongst many other things."
Oh,
good. Well, have her contact me, right, LarryBuell@earthlands.org, and we can talk.
Okay.
We can do our first three minutes of talking, and then we'll talk further. It's interesting. When people come to Earthlands, we say you interview with three groups. One is myself and some of the other managers or core group, and then the other people in the community. And thirdly is the land. You must
Florida. Go
on the land, and you know, that's very, very important to have that connection to the earth.
Beautiful.
Good. Okay, other questions? This is wonderful.
Yeah. Yeah, do we have any other questions from the chat room, JP? Well,
let
I
me
a chance
see.
To
let
take
me
a look.
See.
Let's take a look in. And you can go, actually, Larry, to look into, if you go into, Spirit Radio.
Yeah,
And then there's
right.
a chat
Well,
room
Wildfeather
there.
Has heard of Earthlands before.
Yeah, Wildfeather's from New Hampshire.
Yeah, there we go.
Yep.
And Serena's from Florida.
Oh, okay.
Beautiful. Yeah, and we have networks all around, so we could have her connect with some of our other people there. And I'm on the website. I've been on the website today, so I can see that.
Yeah, if you look in the chat room, and as different people are, you know, I honestly I haven't looked today. I apologize, but let's see. Is there any? Well, let's give your website again to everyone, just to make sure everyone gets it.
Earthlands.org, EARTHLANDS.org. And I'm Larry Buell at LarryBuell@earthlands.org. And I would love to have a conversation, because Earthlands may not be the answer, but we may be able to know. We've got a huge network, and the more I work in this field, the more I realize that there's a tremendous amount happening out there. There's women's programs that are creating centers, men's groups. Of course, we're trying to get the balance of both the gender of the feminine and the masculine. So it's a very exciting time. And I think we know that we're entering something really quite special. And we've been guided by spirit. In my case, I was given directions of where to go and what to do, and I'm trusting the Nipmunk grandmothers are guiding me almost every foot of the way, and we will be having on the full moon, the beginning of the full moon, the 17th and 18th of August, we'll be having a next step at seeding our own community, our international community, by working on our own stone structures. We have some underground chambers that were created about 8,000 years ago. Those are being honored. They were indigenous. And we are creating our own structures. We have a 1,000 mandala program, which is actually a mandala, which is a fundraising episode where people can make bricks or buy bricks for certain periods, certain money. And those are going to be around the world. And they'll be artistic performance spaces as well. So good. I appreciate any of the questions, or we'll move on to our work. So this has been wonderful, and I appreciate Jessica's coming to Earthlands, and it's no accident she came at this very, very crossroads time for Earthlands. We know we are moving to the bigger arena, and it's very good to people know. I was talking with somebody who is the actual host of Women on Air, and she knew all about Spirit Radio, Wolf Spirit Radio. So your word is getting out there, as is everyone else's. It's very exciting.
Oh, that's great. I mean, like I said, it was really, really wonderful for me to be there. And I don't think anything's an accident. And joining together with like-minded people really helps to expand the message. And like I said, Wolf Spirit Radio is doing a wonderful job in providing all different types of information, helping people to be more awakened and aware of what's going on in our world today. And there's so many different shows that are talking about various topics, and you just find which one that you resonate with, which one you feels good. I think it was Rainbow Weaver, and she doesn't ask a question, but she was talking about, I was saying to my husband, if all humans would take off their shoes and reconnect the ground to Gaia and eat good, clean food and be in nature, we would all reconnect, and society as we know it would crumble. And we could truly communicate with each other in Gaia and the earth. Once again, we are all children. We need to show her our love. She is waiting for us. Isn't that beautiful?
That is beautiful. And that first line of that statement, this idea of re-earthing or earthing, is where you actually do have that connection. And there's a book out called Earthing. And it says the greatest secret that we've missed is this connection to the earth through barefoot walking on the earth. And there are people that are starting to do that much, much more. There are schools in America, and certainly in Europe, where they have no structures. They're outside totally. My daughter is in one in San Francisco, where they are outside all the elements. It's raining, they're out. If it's sunny, they're out. If it's windy, they're out. And that's the type of connection. Because once you get connected, you can't lose that. And that's part of the work that we're about. Yes.
Right. And that's why I wrote my books, Green Stories for Green Children, to help parents deliver the message, the same thing, to help them to love being out there. And my little story about Mossy Lassie and Laddie Sod is a cute little story about, children just playing outside, whether it's raining or whether it's, exactly what you're saying right there. And this is before I really connected with anyone. So I think this is really exciting. And I'm so looking forward to more of this type of information and working together with you, Larry, on some level. I know that we'll have John joining us next week. Okay. He will come in on the latter end talking about his information regarding commerce and the exchange of money and the wampum exchange of the way the natives people have done right. It in times past. But I won't go too far into that. That's his half hour. We'll bring that in. And John's last name is? I'm trying to remember.
Junior. E-credits and abundance now. Yeah. And I also make a commitment on some of the many people in our circle. We have Gail Burrington, who is an alternative energy specialist. She could be on. There are other people that are doing tracking. There's one of our members is Bill Pfeiffer, who does Wild Earth, Wild Soul. So we have many people that we could contribute, and I think it's a good forum for all of us.
I've had a thought.
And, and just as I leave you and move on to go looking for edible wild plants, there's a very important thing that the Nipmunks on this land have said. They said, the hardest journey we have to make is from our head to our heart. And that's the work that we're doing, dear friends. So I give thanks and do give gratitude for this invitation to meet with you. And I look forward. I'll be on Wolf Spirit Radio more than you might think.
Larry, speak to me. Listen for a second. Number one, a lady called Serena is going to contact you. When is good? Can she call you right now after you've finished this show?
Yeah, it'll have to be tomorrow, our time, tomorrow morning, Friday morning. I'm off to a program. We have 30 people waiting for us to go on a wild food hunt. So have me, and if she can get my email, then we can agree on a time.
It's can you very pure. Slowly spell out your email, please?
Yeah, Larry Buell, LarryBuell, at Earthlands, earthlands.org.
Okay, thank you very much, Larry. And so she'll hear this in a minute or so. So thank you very much. Yes. If you just expect a phone call. So you put out the word, you got it straight back. Actually, she connected with me today because... Yes. She messaged my site saying there's something going on. What's going on? And I said, tune in now, right now, like half an hour ago when you started coming on. I said, tune in now. And it was like, bang. Cause she calls herself Lady of the Woods.
Okay. Well, I thought, we know that.
You got some stuff going.
And the college need the mentors and she could be a mentor for Earthland. So. We give thanks and enjoy the rest of your day, and we give gratitude.
Thank you so much for being with us, Larry, and we will have you on again.
Thank you so much.
Okay, so.
So that's about it for the show. Wow.
Yes, that was perfect. He's off to do his wild food hunt, and, they live it, they breathe it, they exist in that reality, and he is a very youthful, energetic guy that loves the planet, and I'll tell you one thing, he reminds me, he sort of has a Ralph Nader or Abraham Lincoln appearance. Mm-hmm. And it's kind of a cross between the both, from my perspective. Very, very interesting, very loving, sincere, kind gentleman. And there are so many others there as well. And there's so many others that are part of his extended family and vice versa. So thank you for everyone for listening to the show today. I like to continue to provide information over and above my transmissions and hope this will be a blessing to you. Goodbye for this week, and thank you, JP, and a special thanks to Amy Delgado for reading the part of Petra.
Absolutely. Seconded. Thank you, Amy, and good night, everybody. Oh, and by the way, I'll be replaying my Eva Zemanova interview from Monday, just in case anybody missed it. Whoops. Wrong one. Wrong button. Thank you.